That Hunt-Lesnar fight was going to be at the top of the card. That has since been moved now, and it's going to be Miesha Tate at the top of that card, Dave. It has been a wild week in the UFC world. How are you, pal?
Mike, Gil, I'm good, man. You know, it's funny. It has been a wild week out here in Las Vegas. It's probably been the most challenging week of my professional career, but I'm still smiling. You know what? Tomorrow night, live on pay-per-view, it's UFC 200. I heard you talking about the order of the card. Hell, Mike, it doesn't matter. There are so many good fights, so many former and current world champions. This card will feature more UFC performance bonus winners than any other card in UFC history. Top to bottom, it's stacked. And you know what? You sprinkle in a little drama here and there, and that's what they pay us to do. They pay us to figure it out, and that's what we did.
Before we talk about some of the drama in this card, talk about where UFC is, 200 now, where from where it began to where it is now, and why UFC 200 is so monumental and special.
Well, it's funny, Mike, because I remember 8 years ago coming on your show and telling your great audience that I was making the move to Las Vegas. I was sitting in the parking lot of what, I don't even know if it's there anymore, but what was Foreman Mills on the Black Horse Pike.
They're still chugging along.
There they are. Anyway, free plug for them. I remember sitting there and just realizing what a special opportunity I had, that the sport was just taking off. And this means so much to us. Everything we've accomplished over the last decade plus, whether it's, you know, bringing the sport to the mainstream, introducing women athletes to the sport, whatever it may be, we've continued to take the game to the next level. And I think 200 is a culmination of our efforts to make this truly the biggest global sport in the world. And listen, the NFL's huge, the NBA's huge, a lot of those sports are huge. But when you think about the global impact of the UFC, it translates across all races, language barriers. People get fighting, they understand it. And I think it's a big reason we've been successful. Tomorrow night is the culmination of all that hard work.
And the fact that you have a female topping that card is pretty, it says a lot.
Not just that, we actually have a female fight finalized on the Fox Sports 1 prelims, which is kind of the appetizer to the main card. That features Juliana Pena, Kat Zingano. The winner of that fight could be well poised for a title shot. The sport has come so far, so fast. I always tell the media when I travel the world promoting this sport that I still feel like, in many ways, if you were to look at the evolution of the NFL, we're still in the leather helmet era. Many people think this plane is already up at 30,000 feet. I think we just got off the runway.
That's
Mike.
A good point.
I think where we are heading is for truly global heights, and to be a small part in the overall growth of this sport as a small kid from Egg Harbor Township. It means a lot to me.
He's now the Vice President of Public Relations for UFC, Dave Schaller. So you said it was a trying week. Give us a little insight on what happened once John Jones fails. He's now removed, and all the scrambling that went on to try to fill. And who finds Anderson Silva to fill this spot? Is this the best-case scenario in terms of what happened and how you fixed it?
Well, when you have arguably the pound-for-pound greatest fighter to ever compete in the octagon, Anderson Silva, calling you saying, I want that fight. I want to fight Daniel Cormier.
So he calls you. He calls you guys and says, I will fill in.
He knew we were looking for someone. I'm walking backstage after the Daniel Cormier-Dana White press conference, and Ed Suarez, who's Anderson Silva's manager, calls Dana, and the wheels got in motion. It was trying because, Mike, in the state of Nevada, once a fighter is over the age of 35, they have to do additional medical testing to get them cleared. So Anderson flew into Las Vegas yesterday morning, spent the entire day undergoing the battery of tests as expected and needed by the state of Nevada. He got them done. He was approved. And then he came backstage, gave us a big hug, and it was off to the races. This is a fantastic fight. It doesn't fall off all that far from the John Jones fight. Yes, he's a little bit older, and yes, perhaps you can make the argument that his peak is behind him, but Anderson Silva is that transcendent talent, Mike. He has the ability to change the game with one kick, one punch, one elbow, and that's what makes this so special. And then you think about Daniel Cormier. Daniel Cormier has been preparing for a 6'4", lanky, 82-inch reach, light heavyweight champion who's younger, faster, stronger. Stylistically, the intrigue with this fight is just, it's something special. UFC 200 is here, and all the running around, all this literally the sleepless nights, it's all going to be worth it tomorrow. And then I know, Mike, I know you have a soft spot for him, the big man, Brock Lesnar. When the lights go out in the T-Mobile Arena tomorrow night and his music hits, not his WWE
not
music.
Not his WWE music,
when
right?
His music hits, when he makes that walk, it's going to be something that, in sports you don't get to see all that often.
Well, before I get to him, so obviously Jones, it blows up in your face a little. You put trust in this guy. Obviously, it's disappointing. Dana said it. It's disappointing that you trust this guy. Can you trust him again? Can you put him on another card and believe in him?
You know, that's it's a good question, and I also think John's entitled to due process, Mike. We were not in any way, shape, or form saying he's guilty. We were just notified by USADA, who enforces our anti-doping policy, that there was a potential violation. So he still does have that due process. If this turns out negatively in his favor, he's facing a 2-year suspension. So to answer your question directly, if he is suspended for 2 years, it's not going to be a matter of whether we can put trust in John. But this is an unfortunate situation for an incredibly talented athlete, maybe, you know, that once of a generation Michael Jordan type talent for our sport. And he's had his fair share of hiccups. So to answer your question directly, we've got to let the process play out. But this one stinks. It stinks for John. It stinks for Daniel. It stinks for the fans. And
yeah,
it goes without saying, it stinks for the UFC.
Well, I'm glad that Daniel Cormier was able to get a fight, because I felt horrible for that guy, that he loses out by no fault of his own. So luckily, he's going to get a payday, and he's ready to go. So it's Cormier and Anderson Silva. You mentioned Brock Lesnar. Why Hunt? Why is he the guy for Lesnar? What is the background, if there is any? Why? Because he seems like an odd choice for Lesnar.
Oh, it's not odd at all, Mike. He is what we call in our sport a one hitter quitter. He is the type of guy where if he puts his meat hooks, his bear paws, whatever you want to call, if he hits you with that right hand, there's no one in the sport, maybe on the planet, that can hold up to Mark Hunt's power. It's the classic reason why, Mike, the UFC was created.
Well, that's why I say it's an odd choice, because this is a guy who can knock out Lesnar, who hasn't fought in like 4 years.
Hey, the one thing that I will always respect Brock Lesnar for is he came back and he said, get me the toughest guy you can get me. Brock is, and I've had a chance to work with him since UFC 100, there's no one like Brock Lesnar. You know, you hear a lot about the prima donna antics of athletes in this day and age, and I'm listening to sports talk radio, and they're debating why Durant would go to the Warriors and not win. Brock's none of that. Brock is, in his words, a farm boy.
Yeah.
He wants to fight the biggest, toughest, strongest, and he wants to prove to everyone that whether he was out for 5 years, 5 months, or 5 decades, he's still the baddest man on the planet. He wakes up every morning, Mike Gill, looks in the mirror and says, I'm the baddest man on the planet. And until someone proves us otherwise, maybe that other guy is Mark Hunt, we're going to be in for a real, real treat. And this is one of those fights, Mike, and I know you've been around our sport and combat sports for a long time. It's a don't-blink fight.
That's what I've been hearing, that this could be a violent ending early for one of these two guys, Mark Hunt, Brock Lesnar. So Dave Schaller's with us, the Vice President of PR for the UFC. Tell me, how does this happen? Where this comes out of nowhere. Brock Lesnar decides, I want to fight in the UFC again. He's out there, you know, taking everybody to Suplex City in the WWE. Now, not to mention, they are promoting him for a card in about a month from now. So this is risky for his other profession. Because I listened back to the interview I did with Dana. Now, this was 4 years ago that he said, we sat down with Brock, typical, it didn't go well. Those two guys don't see eye to eye all the time. Why is he on this card?
Because the fire is still burning, Mike, and I think Brock realizes that while he'll be able to do WWE for another 10 years, you know, in our sport, the window closes every day, just like it does in all the other professional sports. The fire was still burning brightly. When he sat down on SportsCenter, what was it, a year ago, and said he was hanging up the gloves and closing the chapter, this chapter of the Brock Lesnar book, I just don't think it's that well. And coming up on UFC 200, he knew that if he was going to make a comeback, this was the right card and this was the right time. He's almost 39 years old, but he looks better than ever. Mike, this is no promoter speak. I know I'm the VP of PR, but this is just you and I here, Mike. I've never seen him in this type of shape. I've never seen him in this type of mentality.
So
He took this seriously.
He fight once and that's it? He just needs to get it. Is he Rocky Balboa? I got to get it out of my system, or do we see Brock again?
Great question. This is a one-fight deal, but because he left the door ajar, I'll leave the door ajar as well. Never say never. If he goes out there and he beats Mark Hunt, who's one of our top heavyweight contenders, who knows? And that's the great thing about the heavyweight division. With the power and the size of these guys, one punch, one takedown, one submission, it changed everything. So my understanding is he's got Randy Orton or one of those guys at SummerSlam in August, and we'll see what happens from there. But he's a crossover star in both of those worlds. And listen, I'm not going to tell him he can't come back. Let's put it to you that way.
Edgar Aldo, rematch title fight. They fought, four, five years ago. Why is this one intriguing the second time?
Well, this one's intriguing because hypothetically the winner will fight Conor McGregor to unify the world titles.
Did you ever consider McGregor to fill the spot?
To fill the spot?
John Jones. Did you ever, was that considered at all?
It wasn't because we were too far down the road on promotion for UFC 200, which is August 20th at the very same arena.
All right.
It just didn't make sense. And obviously the guys would have had to make weight and things like that.
Okay, so the winner of this fight has a chance at McGregor.
They do, but the truth is, if McGregor decides to stay at 170 or 155, there's a strong chance the winner of this fight is ended up being the undisputed champion. I know Frankie Edgar, a Jersey guy, is riding a huge high. Last night, his teammate Eddie Alvarez from Kensington, Philadelphia, knocked out Rafael Dos Anjos on our fight pass card to win the world title. That team is on an all-time high. There's some chatter in this space that Frankie's actually still peaking and maybe time has passed on for Aldo, but I've seen Aldo all week. He has that same fire in his eyes that I saw when we worked together in the WEC. That is maybe not going to get the same buzz as a Brock Lesnar or a Cormier or a Silva. That's one hell of a fight, Mike Gill.
Yeah, and I know Eddie Alvarez said he wants to fight McGregor himself. He said, give me somebody lesser. He wants a weaker opponent. He wants McGregor.
Eddie knows what he's doing. He's one of those tried and true Philadelphia fighters. The first thing he asked us for was a fight at the Wells Fargo Center. And I know, Mike, you could probably imagine I was really arguing against that. Love that idea. I think it's fantastic. And any chance we get to bring the Octagon back to the South Jersey or the Philadelphia market, I'm never going to argue against that.
All right. Dave Schaller's with us, UFC 200. Travis Brown, Cain Velasquez, another Velasquez, big name as well. And then, so give us a quick little overview on why that fight has been, is part of this card, because obviously this is one of your big cards, Velasquez and Brown.
Well, remember, our global appeal, our international growth, Cain Velasquez, the former heavyweight champion, mm-hmm. one of our biggest stars in Latin America, against Travis Brown, who comes from Hawaii. Hawaii, thanks to BJ Penn, has always been a fantastic market for the UFC, so we put those two heavy hitters. Very rarely do you get the former heavyweight champion opening the pay-per-view card against another top 10 ranked heavyweight. That fight, if it goes to all three rounds, I'll be incredibly surprised. You got Cain Velasquez, the classic grinder wrestler with big power, against Travis Brown, who is 6'7", just possesses such range and just dynamic striking. Again, why we got this sport together in 1993 was to test discipline versus discipline. So you're going to have a hard-nosed wrestler against a really dynamic striker opening up 200 tomorrow.
All right. And then Misha and Amanda at the top of the card, who will finish the night off here. What's at stake? It's a title, but what's at stake for the winner, and what's happens to the loser?
Well, listen, Misha Tate, obviously a lot of chatter about a rematch with Ronda Rousey, or if Holly Holm is victorious in 3 weeks, a rematch with Holly Holm. But right now, Misha holds all the cards in that division. She's the champion. She's looked better than ever in the octagon. And her confidence, I've known Misha a long time, Mike, her confidence is at time high. Her striking looks really good. She's obviously a dominant wrestler and submission artist. If she wins, she's going to hold the keys to a big fight, whether it's at Madison Square Garden or at the end of the year in Las Vegas, if she's healthy. And Amanda Nunes, listen, Amanda Nunes trains at one of the best gyms in this sport, an American Top Team down in Coconut Creek, Florida. She has great teammates, great jiu-jitsu. And she's got the dog in her, if you know what I mean, Mike. She brings the fight. If she wins, she not only upsets, Misha Tate, but she probably shocks a lot of the MMA community. Misha's a bit of a heavy favorite here, but Amanda Nunes has that power and those skills And I think we've seen, whether it was Holly knocking out Ronda and then Misha in the round five of their fight against Holly, submitting Holly, you just never know. That that division is only separated by mere inches of talent, and I think we'll see that atop UFC 200.
Pay-per-view, you can get it. And Dave Schaller, if no one has seen the UFC ever, I know you like them all, but if they had to pick one fight and you were trying to sell them on being a UFC fan, which fight should they sit down and watch closely tomorrow night?
What a fantastic question. Really good question. You're getting good at this radio thing, Mike.
And yet people still don't like me. Can you believe that?
Well, listen, anybody who reaches success, you're going to have your fair share of haters. So you just go on your live radio show and say, hi, haters. But I think if you were going to watch one fight on Saturday night, just for the sheer entertainment, I'm going Brock Lesnar and Mark Hunt. You just have no idea what's going to happen, whether it's 15 seconds or 15 minutes. It's going to be all action. I'm picking that by just a little bit of a nose over top of Cormier and Silva. But either way, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, there's not a bad fight top to bottom tomorrow night.
No, it's a great card, and I guess getting Silva to replace Jones is probably the best you could do under the circumstances with less than, 72 hours to put that thing together. God bless Anderson Silva for jumping in there against a guy on the level of Cormier. But it is UFC 200 pay-per-view with Misha Tate at the top of that card. Cain Velasquez will be starting off the main card, and then, of course, a full undercard. Is that on the FS1?
We have our first couple of fights of the night on UFC Fight Pass, and then we move to FS1. Also, Mike, one quick note. We have a world title fight live and free on Fox Sports 1 tonight. It's our strawweight title fight between champion Joanna Jędrzejczyk and Brazilian superstar Claudia Gadelha, 115 pounds. These women really hate each other. If you're looking for a grudge match tonight on Fox Sports 1, little appetizer to UFC 200.
Okay, at Schaller underscore UFC for all your UFC 200 news. Las Vegas via South Jersey. By the way, you bump into Ben Simmons out there?
Hey, listen, I am so fired up about our Philadelphia 76ers. I just like where this team's heading. Ben Simmons, he's like 7'5", yet he dishes the ball like a 6'1" point guard. We got a lot to be excited about. You know, Ronnie Hextall and the Philadelphia Flyers look good. The Phillies are starting to stock up the farm. And then it's almost time for our Eagles. I'm fired up, Mike.
Well, you got a big weekend ahead of you and all the Philly teams. Things are turning around. It's Dave Schaller, UFC 200. Thanks, pal.
Thanks, brother.